the Odisha Development Conclave that every year the civil society organizations, they come together and they organize. And this is the third edition of Odisha Vikas Conclave, which is right now, the opening session is still going on. It has released a book today. It's a wonderful book. Last year, 2018, we have also organized. It's a 600 pages book that has come up with a lot of issues, and that is still going on there. And today, we are having a three different tracks now, three different thematic area that are being discussed under the Odisha Vikas Conclave. And one is in education in COVID, and then we have migration. The third that we are having is today. I need to know that, but what one is the third? Education, migration, and livelihood. Yeah, the farming, natural farming one is coming up. So we are welcoming you all whoever have joined here. In seminar, which will be actually dealing with changing the road from distress migration to safe migration. And we have a very distinguished guest with us, very experienced guest. I will actually invite them whenever they start speaking, and I'll invite them when they speak. And basically, like we will have the three, four areas. Like we will have a community voices, which will come up in terms of videos. We have taken some community voices during COVID, migrant returnees who come back to Odisha, what they have to say. Second, there's a small update about what happened actually in Odisha pre and during, and now we are into a post kind of situation on migrant labor. What is the situation? What happened? So that's a small update. And then we will go straight to the speakers. And once the speakers, and then we would go for a open house discussion. So, all the participants were there. I think please check that you have your chat box. You can also put your questions there. We will put that question and also referred it to our guest speakers. Then now I would request actually Niladri to play the video, that community voices to start with, and then I'll make a small update. The volume is Niladri, the volume is not coming. If you can just see the volume. Or you can take it out. Yes.
Again, Munna Padma Bhoi, Gana Gurunda, Panchayat Goimur.
Umi sir, audience.
Yes.
Jila Bolangi, Rajya Amar Odisha. गला वर्ष आज्ञा आम ईटा गढ़ी देन करोना हबार आज्ञा सरकार आमके फेरे आनले करेंट सेंटर रखले गला वर्ष आज्ञा छुआ ता जेजेमा पाखे छाड़ी आर गली पाठ पढ़े बोली करोना रो तो स्कूल बंद है आज्ञा आईन गाँ के आएला के छुआ मैंने बुलुछन बोली आम ट्यूशन भेजनु आज्ञा सरकार देथिले 2000 टका ट्यूशन सरी गला पैसा आज्ञा काम धंदा किसी ने मिलवा छुआ के पढ़ावार लागि आज्ञा एमे काम धंधा सरकार के देले काम करतूं आरो पाठ साठ पढ़ातूं।
सर नमस्कार, मो ना है तापस दास, मो बयस है 19 वर्ष, गाँव ना है बुर्जरी, पंचायत बुर्जरी, ब्लक बेगुनियापड़ा, जिला गंजम। मोर बापा डेथ है पाठ पढ़ा पढ़ी छाड़ी मुझे गली बाहर को केरल काम कली दिन को 750 एम जी पाऊली। फेर कोरोना ईयरें लॉकडाउन होगला मसे हम असुविधा चलिली, खाया पीया असुविधा है बहुत। तापर फेर बेस कष्ट आसलु गाँव को 14 दिन क्वारंटाइन रही। फेर गाँव में कम फाम से ना दिन को 300 टाँह डेली कम ना लॉकडाउन बहुत असुविधा हो दुखी माग
क्लीयर हो तो
साज कर गाँव में सेठी जमी पैसा कमाऊ रेट से रेट मिलेगा आम रही जा
ना सहेल बवर्ती आ मोर घर तुरेकला गाँ भी तुरेकला ब्लक तुरेकला आउ डिस्ट बलांगीर आला कथा 6 वर्ष होगा मुंबई जाए आसें महिला गले धीरे धीरे लेबर काम करी धीरे धीरे मिस्त्री काम शिखली अब शिख सारापर जो कोरोना महामारी आसला तो बहुत हमको छिनबिन कर पाला आ खा पीबारे बहुत असुविधा है काम कुमार बंद गला 2 मास पहले बस रहलो जिते कमुले पैसा पतर सब सरीगला किसी रास्ता भी हमको ना देखा। तापर आम सब सांग मैंने थी आम ग्रुप थी 10-15 समस्ते कथा हेनु फिर आसलु चलचे 2 दिन तक फिर रास्तार आमको बहुत बड़ बड़ लोग मैंने सहयोग कला से विशेष विशेष धन्यवाद दिल से आगे भगवान खुश रखु आमको बहुत जी जन भी साहय कले बहुत भल कले आगे आम आस पार्लु से मैंने सैकेल पे जोज कले आम लगे इटा कले आसलु आमको 15 दिन लगभग लगेगा आमको आसवार लगे। तापर आसापर इन्हें जिनटा आसलू आम सरपंच पुराण अफिसर आर अन्य विभिन्न विभिन्न प्रकार अफिसर मैंने आसने कहले आमको जे तुमके आज जीवा लगे नहीं पड़े इन्हें काम मिलवा सब करवा क्वारंटाइन रह 21 दिन आम 21 दिन रहा बाहर किसी भी सहयोग ना आमको आम तो गरीब पिला गरीब घर चाषीवास किसी भी ना फिर भी बहुत कष्ट मस्ट झेलुच आप पीछे कण कराए किसी काम कर मिलवा ना जेने एनर्जेस काम भी दौन सीटा तो मसकु 4-5 दिन चलुचे बंद हो आराम हमें भी मिस्त्री काम करसु काम तो हमके नहीं हुए तापर से आम नहीं करवा काम आम भी मसकु 5-4 दिन चलने कण कर 26 दिन बसले आरोप फायदा भी न कि गरीब परिवार 4 दिन काम कले कण काम देवाटा गरीब पार्ले भी नहीं काम दे मतलब नहीं दिए से लगे आम फिर बाध्यना घर असुविधा लगे सियाड़े सी मन फोन करना पैसा पत्र पठेकना फिर जीवा रेडी होमें
Thank you. If you can take out your screen, Niladri. So, yes, it's wonderful. You have already heard the suit. I think someone is actually still putting in this one. Can you please take out the Odisha Development Initiative screen, please, Niladri? Can you just switch off that one? So that
1 second, sir. There is some technical issue. Just stay 1 second.
Please. So, friends, you have heard that these three voices which has come up during COVID. How people have come back. It was a nightmare for many people to come back, and today some kind of normalization is going on, but still there are issues which people are encountering. What happened in post COVID during COVID around close to 800,000 migrant laborers have come back to Orissa, and Orissa is one of the state along with another 5 states. The government of India has said more and more laborers have gone, and there are 15 districts which were identified in the country which has received more than 1 lakh. Orissa had got 2 districts, which are Balangir and Ganjam. Ganjam, we have huge number of people have come, and Balangir and Ganjam together, the total migrants are 35% of the migrants the Orissa has received, and the KBK area, that's the southern and western part of Orissa, has got around 32% of the total migrants who come back to Orissa. South coastal is around 29%, and north coastal region is 15%. So we had laborers have come, and by now 65% to 70% of migrants have gone back to the work, and remaining migrant workers are still waiting because the migration season or the seasonal migration, those seasonal migrants may move back within a couple of months. I think by January, by Pongal, when the festivals are over in tribal area and other areas, then I think people start moving back, those who are actually are seasonal migrants. Odisha, as you know, is a high prevalence distress migration area. Various places we have migration is much more. Skill levels are very low, particularly the tribal area that we see and the underdeveloped area, the skills are very low. And we have recently done a study which also said that more and more adolescent migrants are also moving. Dominance of middlemen and labor contractors are there who actually take the laborer from Odisha. But government have come up with some of the good governance models, like registering the laborers, signing an MOU between other states, and coming up with the NREGA entitlement for people. Some of the good work, I think, in India. Odisha is the only state where you have people are registered under interstate migrant workers act. Each district, every district, although the registration may be smaller, but this has been going on since last 5-6 years, and there is some database available with the government. And government now, during the COVID, has also collected a lot of data, online data, and there are panchayat data, and then the quarantine center data. There's a lot, I think, huge number of databases has been created. I think Odisha is a better position to come back whenever there would be a policy. Now, we see also increasing trend of women migration now, the garment and spinning mills. These are the areas where we see the trend is going on. Family migration is there, where we see the children, infant, adolescent, young people, school dropout. That's an issue also in Odisha, like many places, children are also moving. Now, I think the challenges that along with Odisha, other state would be facing to see that how the Interstate Migrant Workers Act would be implemented in lieu of a new labor code, which is now being introduced. I know various issues or various components which were there in Interstate Migrant Workers Act had been eliminated in the labor code. And let me tell you, Odisha is the state which actually enacted its Interstate Migrant Workers Act before the Central Act came. That means Odisha has contributed to the formulation of this wonderful Interstate Migrant Workers Act and continue to implement it. Then we have an issue like the portability issue. I think within Odisha and people who are going out, how the food entitlement or the PDS or ICDS or all this entitlement, how they to be portable, and also the One Nation, One Ration is a major issue which is coming up. Intrastate migrant workers, although in Odisha and other places, although that is an issue, that how the state could also address some of the issues like the housing, urban employment, social security, and there would be a pro-migration policies. These are some of the issues that Odisha, along with other states, are also neighboring state, is posing a great kind of challenge. But friends, we have very distinguished guest speaker who are there, and very happy and honored to have Mr. R.B. Bhagat from International Institute of Population Science, Department of Migration and Urban Studies, Mumbai, among us. I think he's with us. He is an authority, and he has done excellent work and academic work that is a span like several years, 2 to 3 decades of work he has done. I was reading his interview in the Frontline, that he spoke about how people were actually the stranded migrants, and what is the life after the COVID look like. First to go, I think first I would request actually Mr. Bhagat, how do you see now? I think that's an issue. How do you see the current situation, the pre-COVID situation also? There are structural issues were there with the migrant workers, and the COVID situation has made the situation more worse. And what is the road ahead for them? So I invite Professor Bhagat. Sir, this is all yours. And what I will say, like, we will have around 10 to 12 minutes of intervention. And I request all the participants to put your question in the chat box. So over to you, Bhagat.
Thank you, Mr. Umi Daniel, and Odisha Development Initiative for inviting me. I am very happy to be here, and I see some of my friends here. Sabri is here, and Bipin Jojo, and lots of other friends. So this is a good platform. So I appreciate this dialogue, and the title of the dialogue or discussion, that is from distress migration to safe migration. I think this is a type of paradigm shift occurring globally in respect with international migration. More it is visible, but we have to also translate and implement and understand in the context of internal migration. So distress migration, when we see the change in the paradigm from distress migration to safe migration, there are two, three things very important to recognize and stress. First is that migration is a livelihood strategy, and people should have right to have this livelihood, access to this livelihood in order to diversify their income. So this is first thing that in our thinking about migration, that it is a livelihood strategy. People are resorting it, and the barrier to this livelihood strategy should be eased down. Secondly, that the migrants are sending remittances. They are source of the income, not only for their household, but for the state economy and for the national economy. And third important thing is that migration is also an informal way of skill development. So you can see somebody who is unskilled going as a wage laborer, he learns painting, or he then becomes contractor, or somebody who is just loading or unloading the bricks, but later on he becomes a very efficient and becomes mason. So this is how things are happening. But what is happening in the paradigm of distress migration? I acknowledge that there is a lot of distress migration, and there are a lot of structural factors are there. So one is the agrarian distress, there is a climate change, Odisha is known for cyclones, also floods, droughts, a lot of structural factors are there, which is creating distress. But then distress migration is also, in terms of policy and program, it is creating some sort of barrier. And we do not recognize that migration has certain form of agency also. So it is a structure versus agency. We have to see that, yes, there are structural factors which are driving people to migrate, and these are distressed factors. But every distressed people are not able to migrate. And therefore, there are some people who have agency and who are been forming the network. And so it is network driven, some sort of agency. So this is one thing. Second thing I would like to say, that when people are migrating, and we talk about something law and Interstate Migrant Workmen Act, and as Mr. Daniel has already said, that Odisha was the first state to have Dadan Labor Contract Act in 1975, and then this Interstate Migrant Workmen Act has come in 1979. So we presume that most of the migrants are contractor driven, but this is not happening. There are people who are migrating themselves through network. So this is another third important thing is that when we talk about law and state to take care of, we always think of employer-employee relationship, where the worker is of regular type. But when we see the labor market, only one third labor, or even among migrant workers, one third labor is only regular worker. So 2/3 are either self-employed or daily wage worker. Note, self-employed and daily wage worker, they do not have employer. So employer-employee relationship, that doesn't take into account. So there are large number of migrants who, even if we have law, something will not be covered in the change scenario. Now, another related thing is that it doesn't, it all leads that migration is not a uniform process, doesn't have single form, but it has multiple form, and there are certain categories of migrants who are more vulnerable. And therefore they need protection from the state, whether through legislation or through universal access of social protection. It will be better to have a universal social protection, universal social protection. So the social rights have predominance or precedence over labor rights. This is to be recognized in the sense that 2/3 of our migrant labor are either self-employed or they are daily wage laborer. And this daily wage laborer are badly affected during the time of pandemic. Many of them are SCST, and many of them are seasonal and temporary type. So it doesn't, just mentioned that migration doesn't have a single form, it has multiple forms. And one of the form is this, the circular and temporary migration. We are also migrant, but we are permanent migrant, but we are included in the urban system. We are included politically, economically, and we do not figure in that sense. So it is circular migrant who are temporary migrants, and many of them belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, they need protection. So this is how, and universal protection is more important than protection under labor laws. Now, when we talk about migrant, then one more thing is coming, only we are concerned about interstate migrant. So that is not the case. As Mr. Daniel has also pointed out, we have large number of migrants within the state. And in Odisha, if you see that in inter-district migrants, those who are migrating to Bhubaneswar, Puri, Cuttack, Rourkela, Kendrapada, Berhampur, all there are 3 times larger than those who are going outside the state. So as per census 2011. So this is already a very big chunk within the state, and the state can do a lot of things within, because they do not have to sign MOU with other states, or they should not have to look after to the central government. It is within the state that a lot of migrants are also there. So while we are talking about interstate migrants, we also should look into that intra-state, or particularly the inter-district migration. Now, what is happening already, we know it, that a category of migrants are very, very vulnerable. Although they have certain agency, that why they have migrated, but in spite of their agency, they are vulnerable because of their low wages, low income, and also getting uprooted from their social and social setup. So protection is very, 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 very essential, and state should come out for the protection. Now, related thing is that data. Now, data is coming in from various sources, and there is a lack of data, and sometimes people ask that you are expert, you tell, or many of us are giving estimates, but these are largely guess estimates. We are seriously lacking data. And I am in favor of the data should be, that migrants should not be separated from non-migrant. So household-based data, that is also very, very needed. But there is a now focus that migrant, registration of migrants. So there will be portal and there will be registration, but how these migrants are connected with their families, how they are connected with their village, so entire social setup or household, that is basic. So data from census or national sample survey are very, very important to study how, what type of changes are taking place, how migration issues is related with wider economic and political issues. So we find that in this country, we are seriously lacking, because as you know, that the data from NSSO is only available for the year 2006-2007. And Census of India has not published the data of several tables till now of belonging to 2011 census. So we seriously lack, and this leads to invisibility of migrants. So migrants are excluded as well as invisible. So social protection, we argue for universal social protection should be designed for the migrants and also for the informal sector workers. But let me also add that this will be a type of a step forward. This is not the permanent solution. Permanent solution is the type of development in this country. The rural-urban divide that is occurring, even if you see Odisha, what is happening to coastal Odisha or the highland Odisha or western Odisha, in spite of the effort by the state government, we have KBK, area development project, Western Odisha Development Council, but in spite of the regional disparity, rural-urban divide, that is that you have to also recognize the type of development. And in the type of development, we cannot bypass process of employment, it is a urban divide area. How we take the development process from the big city, so person may be a step forward, but ultimately we have to think in that respect. We have to revive the planning process in this country, including in Odisha, as per 74th amendment to the constitution, 73rd amendment of the constitution for the rural area and urban area, where there should be planning and development process to be integrated with planning, governance and development. What we see today now, that planning is completely abundant. We have projects. We have several projects, village level, we have Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, or we have MG Narega, or we have National Livelihood Mission, or there are so many programs. Each ministry is looking after. There is a lack of convergence. Although in Odisha, we find that there is a Department of Planning and Convergence Department, but convergence should be at the local level. Unless we have a village planning and we integrate MG Narega with National Livelihood Mission, with watershed development, with such Swachh Bharat, I think that is cannot change the rural development scenario. And also the rural development must be integrated with MSME or urban mission, but urban mission is separate. And other programs are separate, MSMEs are separate. So I think this space-place approach, what I always argue and assert, that space-place approach is very important for the convergence.
Yes. You must have Professor village Bhagat, level plan, you
must have panchayat.
Yeah, if you can sum
yes,
up.
So this is what we need for future, where we can have a development vision. Development from the below and inclusive development, and inclusive development should must recognize the role of urbanization. So now we find a negative attitude towards urbanization. But yes, negative urbanization has problem. But we want a different type of urbanization where there should be a right to the city. That means people should have a right to the employment state. Urbanization of the village, urbanization of the rural area. So I think that is urbanization led but inclusive and environmentally sustainable and socially balanced. So that type of, I think, long-term vision we have to think about. So I will stop it here. Then in case required.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Bhagat. I think it's a very rich insight. And you rightly pointed out that's a paradigm that the shift from distress to more inclusive kind of migration. And I know you've spoken about uniform kind of social protection is required for people for migrating and connecting them with their family members. It's not only migrants. And finally, also the individualization of migrants, which are a major issue, and how the planning process is actually will identify the people at the cities, at the rural area, and how inclusive kind of process would be taken up. Thank you very much. I think it's so wonderful to hear from you and be there. I think there will be some question after this, and we will definitely discuss also like some of the points which the participant will actually bring in. Next is Vandana Patnaik. She has been working, and she's one of the voice globally, also like the women work, and also the exploitation which is happening for the women worker. She's representing Global Alliance Against Trafficking of Women, based out of Bangkok, Thailand. So she's joining from Bangkok, and she's an international coordinator for Global Alliance Against Trafficking of Women, and is responsible for the overall coordination of International Secretariat. She has been working for a very long time. She's a voice, and welcome, Vandana. I think it's a pleasure having you with us today, and we have been interacting, and good to have you here. Please go ahead, wherever you think that you would like to speak in Oriya also, please do, because many of the participants are in Oriya, are from Orissa. Welcome, and it's all yours.
Thank you, Daniel. You know, I have not been to Orissa for such a long time that if I speak in Odia now, I might start crying. So I think English will give me a little bit of distance. So thank you very much. It is always a privilege to be part of the Odisha Vikas Conclave. I would like to focus on the challenges of for women migrant workers in a post-pandemic world, and what could be done or what needs to be done to change the contours from distress migration to safe migration. We are still in the middle of the pandemic. Reality is bleak, and all projections for future are terrible. There's a lot that needs to be done, and it will take time. Nobody has a roadmap. So with this sort of, let me try to narrow down my topic a little bit. I think I will focus on women migrant workers from Odisha and outline the steps that could be taken or the ongoing efforts that could be strengthened to address the distress and make migration safe and a positive experience for the migrant workers. It's very good to come after Professor Bhagat, because I could just say that I agree with everything that he said, and you know, then we can move on to Shabri perhaps. So I really do not have anything new to add, but let me just say a few things. So if we want to address distress, we will need to understand the profile of the women migrant workers from Odisha, who they are, and the context of their labor migration, and the factors that are causing distress. Just a little bit of a macro data. Migration is nothing new, you know, within and across borders of nation states, within and across geographical regions, it has always been a reality. And the 2019 data says that there were 272 million migrants, international migrants, 48% of whom were women. And India was the largest country of origin of international migrants, followed by Mexico and China. If we come to workers, as per ILO's global estimate in 2017, there were 164 million international migrant workers, and 96 million male and 68 million female. coming to Odisha, Odisha's migration story is very old and really fascinating. Seasonal migration to Southeast Asia for maritime trade, migration from coastal Odisha to Calcutta during the colonial period are part of our history. Equally, Odisha has been a destination for businessmen from, just to name two states, Gujarat and Rajasthan, for example. Think of the Marwadi business families in every part of rural Odisha, particularly in rural Western Odisha, where I grew up. The first interstate woman migrant worker that I had met as a six-year-old was a health worker from Kerala, who was a lady health visitor in a tiny little place called Bounshuni, where we were living near Bounshuni in a small place called Dahya. So if we're looking at the current wave of labor migration from Odisha, I would also, like Professor Bhagat, I would link it very closely to the deepening of agrarian crisis in the country and also the economic liberalization in the 90s. If you went to cities like Hyderabad, Bangalore, or Cochin in the 1980s, you would not find an Odia worker there. By the late 90s, however, several service sectors and factories in these cities were hiring workers from Odisha. As a research study carried out by Ajibika Bureau, I think you also have a chapter there in Daniel, which it pointed out, they used a very interesting phrase. They said that Odisha has witnessed an emergence of migrarian livelihoods, where migration and agriculture form the major providers, accounting for more than 55 to 60% of the annual incomes. So during the last 30 years, Odisha has become a major remittance receiving state, and migration has contributed to rural economies. Now, women workers. Women workers are a very small part of the bulk of migrant workers from Odisha. In the absence of macro data, let me just give a small example from Ganjam district. A household survey that was carried out by the Center for Women's Development Studies and London School of Health and Tropical Medicine in 2016, it showed that in the villages that they did the household survey, 44% of the households have male migrants and only 7% had female migrants. Just the recent data that you were talking about, Danielle, that the pandemic, the return of migrant workers actually has created some good data. So the estimated number of returnees in Ganjam, for example, was 218,318 men and 4,532 women migrants. So that's the sort of more or less the scale. From other districts, I think the data would be comparable. What is also important to remember or to keep in mind is Dalit households have the highest proportions of both male and female labor migration. And female labor migration is 2.5 times greater among non-Hindu households than among Hindu households. So women, as has already been pointed out, are part of the family labor migration from Western Odisha. We just heard Padma Machi, who talked about her experience. So they go to work together as a family to work in brick kilns at construction sites. Women also accompany their husbands, initially perhaps not as workers, but they do take up paid work while they're at the destination site. And even a smaller number of women migrate independently as domestic workers through self-initiated sort of labor migration plans, or to work in garment factories as part of the, as part of the state-run skills training programs. So the major distress, I'm just repeating, is caused by destruction of the agrarian economy. And the agrarian crisis is actually much bigger than just the agriculture sector. It is everything that goes with or went with rural economy. At the same time, a sharply increasing number of people from rural areas have been displaced by changes in land laws that allowed for reclassification of agricultural land and opened it up for other purposes. So we can add to that the crisis in the, particularly in Odisha context, the crisis in the handloom and craft sector, and lack of any manufacturing sector in the state. So workers are entering the labor markets from a position of dispossession and desperation, and the pandemic basically just intensified this. And we can also add to these problems, the recruitment in the public sector has been kind of stalled for many, many years. And still skills trainings that have been carried out are primarily for the service sector and for the expert-oriented garment sector, absolutely at the lowest rung of the employment, and which are largely temporary. So at destination sites, the living and working conditions have always been way below the decent work standards. So the pandemic actually didn't create any of these problems. They just showed anyone who cared the existing situation and the immediate crisis of returning home because, you know, you've lost your job or you are afraid. So long-term alleviation of this distress, as Professor Bhagat rightly pointed out, will actually require a complete rethink of our development paradigm. Within that, a reform of the health sector. Many families do take loans to meet costs of health crisis. Privatization of healthcare is a major sort of negative driver, if you like, of distress or driver of distress migration. So in the short and medium term, I have just a couple of points. So I think what is important or what needs to be strengthened is workers' education, including organizing and unionizing. Some of the distress is located in the laborers or the workers' weakening position vis-a-vis their employers and the erosion of their existing rights. Wage theft has been widely reported. High proportion of migrant workers actually did not even know who their employer was or who owed them wages. Labor organizers spoke of near total ignorance among workers of their rights under the law. And in the light of what has just happened in the last few months during this pandemic, in Karnataka, for example, which is one of the major destinations for migrant workers, including Odisha migrant workers, including women migrant workers, the government has made it easier for small and mid-sized enterprises to lay off workers and to evade laws on contract labor. Gujarat, for example, the government has extended maximum number of working hours per day from 9 to 12 to reduce overtime payments. Madhya Pradesh, in inspections of manufacturing units employing less than 50 workers will now take place only on the basis of complaints. And disputes between employers and workers will be settled at unit level with no recourse to tribunals. Across India, employers have coerced workers with benefits to resign only to rehire them at lower wages. So these changes are extremely problematic and extremely risky. So on the other hand, on the positive side, what we have seen during the pandemic, particularly, you know, the Odia women workers that I was tracking and I was reading reports on them, they have showed tremendous resistance. For example, we have the story of Mansi Bariha from Balangir, who reported abuse. In the bricking sector, the garment sector's workers in Tirupur and the factory workers in Cochin also went on strike. So there is actually no lack of grit and strength among the women. And the processes of organizing and unionizing and workers' education have begun in Odisha. Our colleagues from NAO are working closely with SEWA, and in several districts, this process is going on. So I think that needs strengthening. And our government of Odisha has centers in Tamil Nadu and Kerala, but those centers, a little more work, a little more focus, they could be actually turned into really vibrant workers' centers. So secondly, I think safety, you know, when we talk about safety or say anything that is safe for women, we often have to make notice or have to take note about the violence. So safety from violence, including violence from intimate partners, including violence from within the family. So I think that is also, that could be included in the workers' education, in the training. And our women migrating for work need to learn to report, and linkages would have to be built at the civil society level with local emergency support centers, local organizations who are doing this. And third, strengthening small-scale sustainable farming. I think Odisha does have very good examples and really sort of, you know, like strong movement for sustainable agriculture. And so creation of cooperatives, market linkages needs to be strengthened. What we already have, I think we can build on that. And continuation of MNREGA, even if MNREGA is not enough, I think the changes that were made with MNREGA, that MNREGA could be used for developing, for making your own assets better, that could be continued. So these would be my suggestions. And I think I would stop there, Daniel.
Thank you. It's wonderful to hear you. And I know it's very interesting that you said the migrarian livelihood. Yes, I have seen that. And we were writing that. I think that is what is from agrarian to migrarian kind of livelihood, which is actually coming up. And yes, I think the vulnerable section, the movement mobility has increased. And what you have emphasized is something like how this distress should be reduced on the longer run. And Professor Bhagat and you both emphasized that how this reduction could be done. And health, you mentioned health is one of the issues that the women worker and who are actually moving out and workers' education, which you have touched upon. I think that is one area where the is a civil society need to understand that how the distress could be made some kind of a positive for worker working hours from women and exploitative wages are some of the issues that you have touched upon. And thank you, Vandana, as usual. I think you have brought in a lot of things, a lot of things to discuss and be there because we'll be, we may have some kind of question hours and we'll be there and answering. Now it's, I invite Mr. Sabarin Nair. He's a labor migration specialist for South Asia, International Labor Organization based out of New Delhi. And he's one of the youngest speaker, I could say. And he's a South Asia. He looks into the issues related to migration. He provides technical advisory services to 7 countries in the sub-region, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. And I think I must mention that recently, Sabari was involved. And also I think I see Professor Bhagat and many organizations, they came up with a roadmap for the post, or you can say the COVID kind of affected migrants. So I would actually say that what is this roadmap and how Orissa could look into this roadmap, which he has presented. I think it's nice to have, I think he's on a holiday. And I know that he's with us. He's all yours, Sabri. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, loud and clear. Great. No, excellent. Such a pleasure to be here. My first Odisha development conclave. So really, I'm very appreciative of the fact that I have been given this opportunity. And what a fantastic list of speakers to follow. But particularly, Professor Bhagat, sir, shout out to you for the fact that you started by saying that as much as there is a movement associated to migrant workers as a result of distress, let us not forget that they come with their agency, that every migrant worker or every worker in distress cannot necessarily migrate. And I want to keep that in mind. I think any conversation on migration should not be limited to agrarian distress. It's almost distressing for me or anybody working on migration issues when every time we hear that every aspect of migration is linked to agrarian distress, there is hope and aspiration. How many of you, I saw here earlier somebody in the chat box, somebody mentioning I'm originally from Odisha, but I'm now based in Chhattisgarh. I can imagine that there was a hope and aspiration linked to that person's movement. I want us to be very clear about that right at the beginning. So thank you, Professor Bhagat, for highlighting that right at the start. And thank you, Daniel. Yes, indeed. You know, when I was hearing Vandana speak about the international migration context, that is certainly the area. And that is how the ILO comes into these conversations, because a big part of the ILO's focus globally has been on international migration. However, it's only been about a couple of years now since I've moved to New Delhi as the South Asia specialist, coming from global migration policy, which I managed previously, coming now into India, recognizing the fact that you cannot have a conversation on international migration in India, a country which is the largest sending country in the world for migrant workers. We cannot have that conversation if we do not make the link between international migration and internal migration. So that is also important for us to keep in mind. Let us not forget that Odisha is as much an important sending state for international migrant workers outside the country as it is a sending state for internal migrant workers within the country. I think these are important caveats to keep in mind, or caveats to make, considerations to keep in mind as we take this conversation forward. When the ILO decided to work on this roadmap, to be very honest with you, we did not do this because of COVID. We started preparing this roadmap, what we call the roadmap for the development of a policy framework for the inclusion of internal migrant workers in India. We did not do this because of COVID. We started this in October last year. We were supposed to finalize this by March this year. It was a 6-month project that we gave ourselves at the ILO, and we worked with two very important partners, Ajivika Bureau that Bandana mentioned, and CMID, the Center for Migration and Inclusive Development, based in Kerala. Along with that, we also decided we are not going to do this just between the three organizations. We needed an advisory committee. Professor Bhagat was a very key member of that advisory committee, along with trade union representatives from SEWA, for instance, and the Employers Federation of India. So we had a whole group of people. There were 10 advisory committee members. The three organizations led by ILO, Ajivika Bureau and CMID that came together to put this together. In March, we were struck by COVID. And when COVID struck us, we decided to take a step back. And by taking a step back, it helped us recognize how many more issues were highlighted because of COVID. That led us to then go back to the drawing board. And we then spent another 7 months just looking at the issues as they came about and for us to then consider them in this roadmap. For example, when COVID happened, we saw how the government of India reacted. We saw the different responses that the government of India put forward. We saw the state governments reacting to the issues. We saw how employers and trade unions and civil society organizations and the others reacted to the issue. That's where we decided that this roadmap should be a holistic response that takes into consideration the role of these different stakeholders. So within that context, let me then give you, we put together 8 stakeholders and the roles that these 8 stakeholders have to play. The first, government of India. The second, sending states. The third, receiving states. The fourth, employers. The fifth, trade unions. The sixth, civil society organizations. The seventh, development aid agencies. And the eighth, the United Nations itself. So it was a comprehensive list of actors that we wanted to consider in recognizing the role that they have to play in putting forward this roadmap. So what does this roadmap consist of? Let's start with the government of India. I won't go into, out of these 8, I will look at perhaps 6 of them. I won't necessarily go into development aid agencies or United Nations. I think the most relevant are the first 6, including that of civil society organizations, which have played a pivotal role, particularly coming out of COVID now, and the role that it has to play in the post-COVID world. So let's start with the government of India. We identified a number of key recommendations that the government of India has to play. The first and foremost, and we've heard this time and again, is the fact that the evidence gap must be bridged. Now, here you've mentioned right at the beginning, Daniel, about how in the case of Odisha itself, there are some good databases present. Certainly, this is not necessarily the case only for state government. Even the government of India has got some good databases. But going back to what Professor Bhagat said, this particular data is not necessarily coherent, either for the policy perspective or at the institutional level. So therefore, we felt, okay, how exactly should this data be put together? By looking at the scale and the nature of movement, by looking at the different migration corridors, by looking at occupational streams of workers, by looking at national, state, and city level data. So it's an entire convergence of data in that sense, for as far as evidence gap is concerned. The second one is with regards to, for the government of India, is with regards to the investment in rural development. Now, I hear very clearly with what we've heard with regards to the distress migration, but there again, we decided, rather than going in for trying to identify new things, let us talk about what the existing recommendations were. There was a National Commission on Rural Labor that was set up, the NCRL, and the NCRL recommended the enhancement of rural livelihood options through securing land rights for socially marginalized groups. So can we start there? Rather than looking at all aspects of it, can we look at existing recommendations that have been made, rather than thinking we need to be new and innovative in our approach? The third recommendation, or the third specific role that we thought was apt for the government of India in conversations with different stakeholders, was the institutionalization or the establishment of a nodal agency on migration. Currently, what we have is a Ministry of Labor and Employment really taking the lead on it, but the Ministry of Labor and Employment has a whole range of factors associated in terms of the kind of work it does. And I think what this country deserves, and what the migrant workers of this country deserve, is a nodal agency that they can look to for the issue of migration. And therefore, this nodal agency, for instance, would work on issues like the systematic gathering of data, the recommendations that it will put forward for industries. And I'll come to that in a bit in terms of what kind of industry we need to look at. Facilitating interstate coordination, portability of various entitlements, fiscal allocations. One of the biggest factors we know is that migration really does not have a budgetary allocation in our country. And I think that should be an important focus. A national helpline. Now, we all talk about how these helplines either work or don't work. But if there is a nodal agency, then at least it can immediately put forward a list of grievances that the nodal agency can take into consideration. So that was the third one. The fourth one is, of course, the implementation of the labor clause. I was happy to hear, Daniel, what you were saying about the Interstate Migrant Workmen's Act being perhaps one of the acts that the Odisha government followed very closely, including for the registration of migrant workers as an example. But you know, right there, the fact that it said Migrant Workmen Act, the fact that it was not gender responsive in itself, in its thinking, I think goes to show there is so much that needs to be done. I think the four labor codes now provide us that ability to be more gender responsive, to be child sensitive, to be human rights based or labor rights based in our approach, whole of government approach, whole of society approach. These four labor codes provide us that opportunity. And therefore, the implementation of these labor codes will be very, very pivotal. And the role that all of us have to play in the implementation of these labor codes will be extremely important. The fifth is to strengthen labor administration. Now, when we talk about labor administration, once again, the departments of the labor at the state level are extremely, they're constricted, they're constrained. They don't have the ability to now contribute more. So therefore, we need to focus on the labor departments. They need to be able to undertake grievance redressal mechanisms and so on. A couple of points with regards to the government of India, and then I'll come to the other ones and I'll finish in the next 3 to 4 minutes. So what do we have in terms of industries? let us look not just at small and medium enterprises, let's look at micro enterprises. Micro enterprises are the largest providers of employment for the most vulnerable of migrant workers. So let's keep in mind a specific policy recommendation for micro enterprises, which government of India can look at. Let's look at urban policy formulations, which the government of India has an important role to play because migrant workers are in the urban settings as well. So let's not only look at rural areas, let's also look at the urban areas. And of course, importance of fostering social dialogue where trade unions, employers, and government comes together in all settings when it comes to formulating these policies. The other one is the sending and receiving states, the second and the third stakeholders that have an important role to play. Now, Uttar Pradesh is as much a sending state as it is a receiving state. I can assume this is the same for most states in India. For that, we should address sending states should be addressing not only rural distress, but they should also be mapping and prioritizing the districts, the blocks, the sub-blocks within their states in terms of where they see the highest out-migration. Facilitation centers. Vandana is absolutely right. There is a lot of criticism about facilitation centers or these workers' centers that may or may not work. And I think we need to play a bigger role in making sure state governments need to play a bigger role in making sure that these facilitation centers and workers' centers are much more effective. Investing in education, skills development, and vocational training. Now this, by investing in that, and this is something that Vandana mentioned, what I will add to that is to say, by investing in education, you're breaking the intergenerational transfer of poverty. Because this is what is happening. A lot of migrant workers are continuously in that circle of poverty. That circle of poverty is being passed from them to their children and so on. So we need to be able to break that. And this is where education plays such an important role. Access to financial products and services, both in sending and receiving states. Adaptation capabilities of migrant workers, particularly migrant households, with regards to the through the income that they receive, the remittances that these families get, how best are they going to be able to use these incomes? Maybe one other couple of point, I mean, apart from gender response and all of that, would also be to say, what specific disaster risk reduction perspectives can be put in place in the receiving states for migrant workers? And I think that is something we have now clearly seen as a result of COVID. My last two or three stakeholders that I think we need to importantly keep in mind, employers, trade unions, and civil society organizations. For employers, they have to ensure basic provisioning for workers. Occupational safety and health, wash. Water and sanitation and health and hygiene facilities. If employers can ensure just these two elements of basic provisions, it will change across the board the situation of migrant workers. Decent work standards along supply chains. Let's not forget that you don't just get contracted to someone. We know about contractors and we know about subcontractors, the chains of subcontractors. So let's keep the supply chain in mind in any conversation. This is where employers have such a big role to play. What you can also do, what employers can also do, is formalize along the supplier chain. One simple element of formalization, work contracts. Ensure very clear work contracts for all migrant workers, irrespective of the role that they play, the skill that they have, whatever it may be, the tenure of work. Keep the fact that work contracts can help formalize. Trade unions, one of the biggest issues that we are facing, and trade union representatives themselves, is they're not able to collectivize and organize these informal migrant workers simply because they are in the informal sector. So I think that is something that trade unions will certainly play a big role in now. And perhaps a second one would be to build on existing labor collectives. Finally, on civil society organizations, promoting service delivery to be key. And this is where civil society organizations have to play. Daniel, you would remember when we first heard about all the situations that happened to migrant workers as a result of COVID, Niti Aayog chairman sent a fantastic communication to all civil society organizations, thanking them for their work. we need to use that now as a flag for advocacy to say how civil society organizations can contribute in the post-COVID situation as well. And civil society organizations are key in terms of incubation of community-based organizations. Because at the end of the day, it is about migrant workers in or from communities themselves. I'll stop there, Daniel. Thanks so much for the opportunity.
So wonderful. I think it's a lot of insight, Saviri. And the roadmap, I think a lot of ingredients are there. I particularly, I think the stakeholders that you talked about, the civil society, the government, the owner, and also like, you know, the development aid agency, UN, employers, trade unions, all sending and receiving areas. And I know, I think a lot of things could be done. I think government is also waking up because of this COVID. COVID has actually exposed the policy issues, which were lack of policy issues for the migrant. And what I could, I also see a lot of comments coming in. One or two issues that how these reforms which the government is bringing in. Mr. Prusti is saying between migration and trafficking, facilitating migration, trading on migration, protecting migrants and promoting safe migration. Is labor law reforms being discussed going to help migrants? The labor codes also, like whether Bisaka is writing, like the labor code, how it gives a window to talk about labor and migration from gender perspective. That's very important. I know there will be more kind of thing, but yes, this labor reforms, and thank you, Saviri. I think be there. I think we have another half an hour to discuss. And I think we have a lot of things on the table. And you rightly said that it's from the distress and also it's a hopes and aspiration are the key for which actually people, and we have shown you the three videos. I think one of the young guy who, the second, he migrated to Kerala and he was saying that I was earning 600, 700 rupees. I think that's kind of young people are migrating out. So that is where we are, Odisha, also we are experiencing. Now what I will do, Professor Bhagat, just 1 minute, I think, how do you see the current kind of reforms which are coming up? And many of the states, they said they're going to have labor commission at the state level. Another labor is also like, you know, we are talking about labor, welfare, enforcement. Some of the state has a larger role also to play. How do you see this? I think all these things emerge, like some states say they are going to have labor commission. Saviri has actually brought out this issue, the nodal agency. I think that is what we also on the migration day we emphasize. I think the India should have a nodal agency to manage migration. Your take on that, Professor Bhagat? Yeah, please unmute Professor Bhagat, please. Yeah. Niladri, are you there? Can you unmute Professor Bhagat?
What's your Yeah, thank you. So yes, Omi, thank you very much. This question is very important, and what I see that we must move when we talk about migration in a larger context, from governance to the development. How we can move from the issue of governance to development, integrating migration with development. So if you see governance issue, we are going migrants, we are isolating migrants from their household or from their place of origin, from their social structure, from economy, and looking in a very technocratic way from helping them. So this is how then we get frustrated. Whatever is law was there, law was not implemented. Law was inadequate. As I told earlier that Interstate Workmen Act will be applicable when there is a contractor-driven migration.
But two-thirds of migration is taking place by network. So a large part will not be covered. And when contractor is taking the migrants, he contractor is not registered. Then contractor changes, so many things happen. So this is, I think, a very big issue. And then employer is invisible. Not only the migrants are invisible, but employer is also invisible. So we have created a type of production system or flexible exploitation or flexible appropriation of labor in such a way through contracting, through outsourcing, that employer is invisible and we have contracted. So therefore, when the law is there, law is not implemented. So therefore, the question, whole question is that these are, however you make reforms in labor, there will be huge problem in protecting the rights of the migrants. This can help to some extent, but not the what we desire. And integrating with development is very, very important. Now, in that respect, one quick point I will make and then stop. Now, how to increase the bargaining power of the migrants, unless migrants have the bargaining power. And therefore, it is not only social protection or social inclusion, it's a political inclusion. Now, I can give the example. In the recent Bihar election, only 54% people voted. Now, Bihar, you know, a politically very conscious state. How come 54%? Because there were a large number of migrant population who are living outside, and they are disenfranchised. And therefore, portability of voting rights is very, very important. So I will stop and then some more.
Yes, I think, thank you. Thank you, Professor Bhagat. Yes, I think that is one issue. The political inclusion of migrant workers is a key, I think, because for the international migrants or the people who are leaving, the expats or Indian origin, I think government has already provided then the voting rights, they could actually vote electronically. I see that some of the from Bikin Jojo, welcome, good to see you that you are here. Migrants are not homogeneous, as Vandana said, who are they and where they are from. The regional divide within Odisha is important. For example, he says like most of special trains run to coastal Odisha, but not to West Odisha. Very important point this year is the mobility of migrants and also the revenue that's being collected by the railways from Bihar and all the key trains which are going and the Orissa and the kind of inconvenience being caused. I know from Western Orissa, people go during a particular time and people used to say, there's a Kumbh Mela, you have a special train. When migrants are going to work in southern states, why not you have also have a special train so the people should migrate. Also like, what's the, like the safe migration is being advocated and migration registration has been talked about. Niharika Sahu, she's saying, still I think there are people are saying the labor code is a problem that I will actually take to, the labor code part I will take to Sabri, but now, Vandana, the issue like, yes, I think there is also like, you know, when we're talking about there are opportunity, huge opportunities are also there. So the gender and the migration, how the government could come forward and not only provide some help center at the state and they only recruit women and take and employ them in garment industry. And how, what will be the role of the government at that, at the destination? How women worker will be protected? How women worker issues should be addressed at the receiving end and also the inclusion at the source? Over to you, Vandana.
You know, when we are talking about women migrant workers, each sector has a specific, again, you know, it has its specific requirements or specific profile of each sector. So if we are talking about the garment sector workers, the women who are migrating from Odisha to work in the garment sectors, Again, within that, we see some of them are employed in the spinning mills, some are employed in the production, this thing. What we see there, the ones that we visited, Vishakha and I visited some of the factories in Tirupur last year, for example. I have been to some of the factories in Bangalore as well. So those kind of thing, what we notice is there is a mix. There are some workers who go through the government channel after a training. In Tirupur, in the spinning mills, for example, we also saw women workers who had gone again, you know, like individually or sort of in organized outside of the state sending them. This was sort of privately organized. So within all that, I think in the countries, I mean, in the communities of origin, definitely more information about where they are going, what exactly is the, and what their rights are. In the factories, there are internal complaint committees, but do they have the understanding what those committees are, what they can complain about, and do they have, protection? Suppose they complain about something, what is the guarantee that they would leave the jobs? So I think one, like I already mentioned, these worker centers, what they are called, the migrant, you know, like in Tirupur, there is one, in Cochin, there is one, or it's a government runs those. Lots of space, lot of, you know, you can do a number of things there. But there wasn't a person who could speak Odia. There wasn't any sort of facility where the workers could come. So activating some of those would be absolutely important. And like trade union colleagues from Bangalore, for example, say that it's very difficult for them to include workers from the eastern states such as Odisha, Jharkhand, because many of them are not really inclined or do not have an understanding of what is the benefit of being part of the trade union. So I think workers' education and starting at a very simple kind of, you know, cultural meetings, this and that, and slowly moving on to this thing would be probably important. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Vandana. Mr. Prushti is saying like there's a mission approach to migration is necessary and cannot be limited to the hands of labor commissioner. And also like Professor Bhagat has also brought in, Sabri Nair has brought in this, so like, no, you need a separate kind of organization to deal with migrant worker. Sabri, I'll come to you now because there is a fear, there is anxiety. Also, like, you know, people are talking about the labor code. I remember I appeared before the parliamentary standing committee when it was drafted, and I've argued for the larger kind of, you know, support, entitlement, and recognition of migrant worker to have a separate chapter also in the labor code dealing with the labor code. But also, there are also, I'm disappointed to see that many of these recommendations were not there in the final, whether it's a family, whether it's a portability of other issues. It talks about portability only once, the labor code. That it talks about only PDS portability, and that is not coming under the purview of labor code. That comes under One Nation, One Ration Card. So that's a separate program. And we talk about women going with their children, women are moving. There are a lot of other things. I'll just take one example in the rules. I know civil society can play a larger role influencing the state government or framing up rules. One rule, earlier Interstate Migrant Work Act used to have, it had a lot, provision. The recruiter will provide accommodation to the workers. I'm really surprised to see that labor code has taken it out. That means most of the migrant worker will go to the cities, have to be, either they have to stay like in Kerala and rented apartment or rental houses provided by the government. So I know there are some areas with civil society. I know civil society also here, I see that people are voicing that. There's a concern. How do you see that in the long run helping labor code, particularly migrant worker. I know there's various component how migrant workers are going to get benefit. Yeah, over to you, sir. Please unmute, Sabri, King, yeah.
Thanks, Daniel. You know, this question is actually perhaps the question for an ILO official. You're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't, okay? So let's be honest about it. You know, I also appreciate the messages from somebody who is called user and somebody who's called Zoom user. You know, always good to identify yourself in each webinar so that you don't come across as being clandestine in your inputs. Huh? Look, I'm not convinced that the labor codes are ineffective, okay? And that is simply because they just got endorsed in September. I think the bigger question that a lot of trade union, for instance, constituents, and it's important as ILO for us to also recognize what our trade union constituents are saying, is that the labor codes did not necessarily take into consideration their views before their adoption. So for me, that is priority and important for us to keep in mind, and it is important to respect what they are saying. The second thing is this, and I like what Professor Bhagat said, do not implement codes or legislative frameworks for migrant workers alone. This should be about workers in general, okay? This is the reason why in any conversation on internal migration, when it comes to internal migration, and you mentioned that I cover 7 countries, and in all these countries, internal migration is not seen as a migration issue. Internal migration is seen as an employment issue. Is seen as a jobs issue, is seen as a livelihood issue. So we need to recognize, so as much as we are giving it importance by focusing on it as a migration issue, we need to also recognize that workers are workers irrespective of whether they are from Odisha or Kerala or West Bengal or Rajasthan or Bihar, because at the end of the day, they are within their own country. And therefore, this should be a holistic implementation when it comes to the labor codes. Don't look at the 4 labor codes in silos. Each labor code is interconnected with each other. The OSH code is interconnected with the Social Security code, which is interconnected with the Industrial Relations code, which is interconnected with the Wages code. I'll give you an example in terms of some of the elements that are being considered. You know, the Wages code, for instance, this is the first time that the Wages Code actually says that the coverage of the provisions for minimum wages has now or should now be legally extended to all employees, right? Now, this is a tremendous, this is big, this is massive, because this, according to our analysis, this says that this has led to a net increase of 76.4 million wage earners, okay, who are protected by the code. So an additional 76.4 million will be protected by the code. Remember, I'm not defending the code. What I am saying is how the code has now taken into consideration some of these elements. The implementation will be key. It does not, however, the problem now, however, that we have seen is this does not take into consideration domestic workers, okay, who are majority who? Women. Because domestic work is not necessarily legally recognized as work in our country. So imagine now in the case of international migrant workers, women who are moving for domestic work outside of the country, how are we even going to talk about their rights if we don't recognize it within our own country? Now, the code on occupational safety and health, for instance, this code now takes into consideration a broader definition than what was there in the Interstate Migrant Workmen Act. In fact, the code now states it takes a notable step forward by reviewing what the definition is for Interstate Migrant Workmen Act by including those who go beyond those who are recruited by contractors or employers alone. That is tremendous, because now it brings into the whole perspective on those who are self-employed and footloose laborers as well. Who are the self-employed workers? The self-employed workers are also home-based workers, majority women, self-employed workers, domestic workers. So that's the reason why I think it is important for us to link in each one to the other. Otherwise, we will be looking at these in silos. And perhaps one last point on the Social Security Code as an example. the Social Security Code, in fact, recognizes gig and platform workers, okay, who are a large majority migrant workers, and mandates that the central and state government set up funds for unorganized sector workers. Who are the unorganized sector workers? Including home-based and self-employed workers. My point is, Daniel, that all of these things are linked. So just to make sure, I think the bigger question for now is not to say that the labor codes are not effective, because I don't think we are in a place to say that yet. We need to work to make sure that they're implemented effectively. Just one other point. For instance, none of the codes talk about intrastate movement. And we clarified this actually with the Labor Ministry. And the Labor Ministry said that the reason why intrastate movement, which is actually the biggest movement, has not been considered is because intrastate is up to the state. So I'm curious to know now, Daniel, how we can turn this back, these questions back, to say, right, what is the state government going to do for intrastate migrant workers, right? I think that's where we need to now put our energy, rather than now saying that the labor codes are not going to work. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. I think that insight is really good. It clarifies some of the issues. And we hope, I think, the labor code actually would actually provide the protection and the aspiration of millions of migrant workers who are actually moving within or outside. And you rightly pointed out also, like, you know, state is a larger role to play. And since the government has already started framing of rules, we hope, I think, migrants' workers' rights should be ensured and protected everywhere, both the sending and receiving state. Migration is going to be there. I think that's the reality that we are all facing. And as rightly you pointed out, migration for work, I think people are actually going to work, and how the facilitation could be done. And the civil society could actually come together and also help migrant workers to protect their rights. And the way I think, Saberi, you said that the Niti Aayog has actually appreciated civil society organizations by reaching out to the migrants. So friends, I think it's such a wonderful discussion. May I ask all of you to switch on your videos now, because the organizer want to take a photographs of everyone for our records. Today, Odisha Vikas Conclave is actually going on, I think, taking up a lot of such programs. Today, we have also other events were lined up till the evening, and I hope the participant who are here has greatly actually benefited from the discussion. We couldn't provide space to others to speak, but we could have all your comments, and we're going to put that. And also, this will help whatever I think our speakers, the guest speaker has spoken, but Bhagat, Vandana and Saberi, many thanks to you, thankful to you for your time that you have given. And we are putting together, because the government of Odisha has already asked us, what is the roadmap that Odisha Vikas Conclave is going to suggest to the government. And the secretary was supposed to be here today, the labor and employment secretary, but she also asked me that how, if I could actually communicate her about the outcome, and she want to go through the entire video to hear what the actual speaker had to say. So we'll be sharing, Odisha Vikas Conclave would be sharing the videos and the entire thing to them. And I'm thankful to my colleagues, Niladri, and my colleagues who have actually done a lot of work on the background, on the backdrop. Thank you very much, guys. I think it's wonderful that we are making all of us and all the participants, I could see them faces now, are actually relentlessly working for the rights and entitlement of migrant worker. Such a wonderful gathering. Thank you all of you that you have joined and enriched the discussion. Thank you very much. And as Saberi has said, that we have a lot of things to do, and civil society can rally around and work for at least the labor codes, educate people, what Vandana has said, and Professor Bhagat has said, that the government should come up with its plan for reducing vulnerability. And I think that is one, today you made the headline Professor Bhagat to have an independent organization in India to look into the migration issue. I think, thank you very much.